The theme of the 12th lecture is Robert Burns is a pioneer of the Romantic movement. Objectives. By the end of the lecture, students will be able to understand Robert Burns' position as the national poet of Scotland and his appeal to Romantic era audiences as a natural poet, an example of primitivism. Identify characteristics of Romanticism in Burns' poetry. During the lecture, the following questions will be discussed. The first, poet's life. The second, Robert Burns' poetry. And the third, Burns' day. Robert Burns is a national poet of Scotland. Although his poems are somewhat difficult to read because of the Scottish dialect, the dialect is one of the reasons Burns is a central pre-romantic figure. Long before the popularity of the 20th century multiculturalism, Burns preserved in his poetry the Scottish language, culture, and heritage. Burns embodies the concept of romantic primitivism, and his poetry exemplifies the glorification of the common man, the individual indicated by life and nature. The son of a Scottish farmer, Robert Burns was born 2 miles south of Ayr in Alloway, South Ayrshire, Scotland, the eldest of 7 children of William Burns. He was born in a house built by his father, now the Burns Cottage Museum, where he lived until Easter 1766, when he was 7 years old. William Burns sold the house and took the tenancy of the 70-acre Mountain Elephant Farm, southeast of Alloway. Here Burns grew up in poverty and hardship, and the severe manual labor of the farm left its traces in a premature stoop and weakened constitution. He had little regular schooling and got much of his education from his father, who taught his children reading, writing, arithmetic, geography, and history, and also wrote for them a manual of Christian belief. After a few years of home education, Burns was sent to Dalrymple Parish School during the summer of 1772. By the age of 15, Burns was the principal laborer at Mount Elephant. During the harvest of 1774, he was assisted by Nelly Kilpatrick, who inspired his first attempt at poetry. Oh, once I loved a bonny lass. In the summer of 1775, he was sent to finish his education with a tutor at Corcoswold, where he met Peggy Thompson, to whom he wrote 2 songs, Now Westling Winds and I Dreamed I Lay. His wife Jean Armour was the daughter of a stonemason in Mochland, Ayrshire, where she met Robert Burns in 1784. When Jean fell pregnant, Burns was reluctant to marry her, but did apparently promise that he would stick by her. In September 1786, Jean gave birth to twins, but it was only after she had twins again in March 1788 that Burns married her. Jean bore Burns 8 children and raised 1 by a mistress, but only 3 survived into adulthood. She had a very good memory and an aptitude of quoting verse. Burns read almost all his works to her and admitted benefiting from her judgment. After the death of her husband, whom he outlived by nearly 38 years, Jean lived a modest but comfortable life in their last family home in Dumfries. It is from this period only that portraits of her exist. In the years 1784 to 1788, Burns engaged in simultaneous illicit relationships that produced several illegitimate children. In 1785, he fathered his first child, Elizabeth, born out of wedlock to his mother's servant, Elizabeth Peyton, while at the same time he was courting Jean Armour. When Jean became pregnant, her father forbade the two to get married, and Jean honored her father's wishes, at least temporarily. Enraged at Jean's rejection, Burns began wooing Mary Camberwell and considered running away with her to the Caribbean. However, Mary suddenly died, changing his plans. Amid the domestic chaos in Burns' life, in July 1786, he published his first major volume of verse poems, chiefly in the Scottish dialect. Critics praised the work, and its appeal spanned different classes of Scottish society. Within this sudden success, Burns decided to stay in Scotland, and that November, he set out for Edinburgh to bask in the glory. Getting acquainted with the poetry of Robert Burns, we notice that the composition and style of his works are dominated by elements of folk poetry. He uses repetitions, refrains, beginnings, etc., which are characteristics of folk songs, tales, and ballads. The mixing of different genres, the free combination of strings with different size and rhythm, the mixing of strings of different metric lengths, all this was taken by Burns from folklore, but creatively reworked and acquired, therefore, a new strength, beauty, and value. Mixing genres into lyric poetry, epic dramatic elements are extremely enriched it and made more flexible, allowing deeper and more truthful to show him the world of the senses, embedded and even flow. The main themes of his poetry are love and friendship, man and nature, clashes of personality and people with public violence and evil. Free spirit of the Scottish people lives in his works. The patriotic spirit of national pride impregnates Burns' poetry, and in the native song folklore he finds an inexhaustible source of poetic images, themes, and motifs. Burns' name is associated with a special form of the stanza, triple A, B, A, B, with shortened fourths and six lines. And at the same time, all the stanzas of Burns are permitted with the melody of old Scottish poetry and music. Such scheme is known in medieval lyrics, in particular in Provençal poetry, but since the 16th century its popularity has faded. It remained in Scotland where it had been widely used by Burns, but is associated with his name and known as the Burns stanza. Although its official name is the Standard Gabby, it goes from the first works that brought fame to his verse in Scotland, Elegy on the Death of Gabby Simpson, Piper of Kelbarton. Robert Simple of Bestrica, Gabby is not a proper name but a nickname for the natives of the town of Kilbarton in the west of Scotland. This form was used in Russian poetry, for example, in Pushkin's poems Echo and Collapse. In Edinburgh, Burns made many close friends, including Agnes Nancy MacLehose, with whom he exchanged passionate letters, but was unable to consummate the relationship. Frustrated, he began to seduce her servant, Jenny Clough, who bore him a son. Turning to business, Burns boyfriended James Johnson, a fledgling music publisher, who asked him for help. The result was the Scots Musical Museum, a collection of traditional music of Scotland. Tired of the urban life, Burns settled on a farm at Ellisland in the summer of 1788 and finally married Jean Armour. The couple would ultimately have 9 children, only 3 of whom survive. In 1791, however, Burns quit farming for good and moved his family to the nearby town of Dumfries. There he accepted the position of excise officer, essentially a tax collector, and continued to write and gather traditional Scottish songs. That year he published Tam of Shanter, a slightly veiled autobiographical story of the farmer, which is now considered a masterpiece of narrative poetry. In 1793, then, he contributed to publish George Thomson's A Select Collection of Original Scottish Airs for the Voice. This work and the Scots Musical Museum make up the bulk of Burns' poems and folk songs, including the well-known pieces Auld Lang Syne, A Red, Red Rose, and The Battle of Sherrymoor. Burns' preface to the 240-page Kilmarnock poems, chiefly in the Scottish dialect, published in 1786, presents the author as one who lacked all the advantages of learned art. The book, published in an edition of just over 600 copies, contained 44 poems in Scots and in English, including such substantial recent works of Scots Drink, The Twa Dogs, The Vision, and The Quarter Saturday Night. Thanks not least to the large number of subscribers obtained by Gilbert Burns and the poet's friends, the edition sold out in a month, making Burns a profit of over £50. John Wilson wished Burns to advance money for a second edition, but the poet was reluctant to hazard this. The book had won him intense local admiration among the common people and gentry. A local minister, the Reverend George Leroyer of Loudoun, sent Burns' poems to an Edinburgh literary friend, the blind poet the Reverend Thomas Blacklock, who asked his professor Dougal Stewart to read some of the poems aloud to him. Blacklock wrote enthusiastically to Laurie, hoping that there would be a second edition of these poems, and his letters was passed on to Burns, who soon gave up his immigration plans. Robert Burns was a man of great intellectual energy and force of character who, in a class-ridden society, never found an environment in which he could fully exercise his personality. It may be argued that Scottish culture in his day was incapable of providing an intellectual background that could replace the Calvinism that Burns rejected, or that Burns's talent was squandered on Edinburgh literacy that, according to English critics, were second-raters. Yet he lived during the cultural and intellectual tumult known as the Scottish Enlightenment, and the problem was ultimately more than one of personalities. The only substitute for the rejected Calvinism seemed to be the Burns' a sentimental deism, a facile belief in the good heart as well. And this was arguable that not a creed rich or complex enough to nourish great poetry. That Burns, in spite of this, produced so much fine poetry shows the strength of his unique genius, and that he has become the Scottish national poet is a tribute to his hold on the popular imagination. Burns perhaps exhibited his greatest poetic powers in his satires. There is also remarkable craftsmanship in his verse letters, which display most adroit counterpointing of the colloquial and the formal. But it is by his songs that Burns is best known, and it is his songs that have carried his reputation around the world. Burns wrote all his songs to no tune, sometimes writing several sets of words to the same air of the endeavor to find the most odd poem for a given melody. Many songs which it is clear from a variety of evidence must have been substantially written by Burns, he never claimed as his. He never claimed Auld Lang Syne, for example, which he described simply as an old fragment he had discovered. The full extent of Burns' works of Scottish song will probably never be known. Uncertainty about the status of Robert Burns as a romantic poet is a consequence of his life and literary career preceding the publication of Wordsworth's and Coleridge's Lyrical Ballads in 1790, a work commonly deemed the genesis of what has since become known as Romanticism. The inevitability of Romanticism is problematic when trying to define Burns' part in it. He sustained his literary career commencing in 1771, although not published until 1786, till his death. Only 2 years prior to the publication of Lyrical Ballads in 1796. This two-year interval has resulted in the marginalization of his work from romantic canons and criticism. In identifying the extent of Burns' influence on and contemporary to the principles Wordsworth establishes in his preface to Lyrical Ballads, I would show how Burns is deserving a recognition as a romantic poet. Burns' song, My Heart is in the Highlands, is a nostalgic monologue from the voice of someone absent from the Scottish landscape. The first half stanza may have been all the remained of the original song, perhaps the consequence of the Union of England and Scotland in 1707, and the scholarly prioritization of standard English, both of which ensued an oppression of traditional Scottish literature and song. Burns respectfully confirms to the old form of employed of trichoic foot, four-line stanzas and rhyming couplets. The conservation of the old first half stanza prosody correlates with the nostalgic tone of the lyrics. The preservation of the old form is also appropriate to the portrayal of imaginary through memory. Burns Night is annually celebrated in Scotland on or around January 25. Its ceremony reads the life of the bard poet Robert Burns, who was born on January 25, 1759. The day also celebrates Burns' contribution to Scottish culture. His best-known work is Auld Lang Syne. The Scottish flag is often displayed at Burns Night celebrations. At Burns Night events, many men wear kilts and women may wear shawls, skirts and dresses made from their family tartan. A tartan was originally a wooden cloth with a distinctive pattern made by using colors of weft and warp when weaving. Particular patterns and combinations of colors were associated with different areas, clans and families. Tartan patterns are now printed on various materials. Many types of food are associated with Burns Night. Whiskey is the traditional drink. In his final 3 years, Burns sympathized with the French Revolution abroad and radical reform at home, neither of which was popular with many of his neighbors and friends. Never in good health, he had several bouts with illness, possibly attributed to a lifelong heart condition. On the morning of July 21, 1796, Burns died in Dumfries at the age of 37. The funeral took place on July 25, the same day his son Maxwell was born. A memorial edition of his poems was published to raise money for his wife and children. Concluding the lecture, we can say, Robert Burns was a poet of all forms. His poems, letters, songs accurately portray the life of Scotland of the 18th century. Burns has, or at least should have, earned an acknowledgement as a romantic poet. Today, Burns' works is known and loved by many people. Lots of countries have translated Burns' work into their languages. The lecture is over. In order to check your understanding, answer the given revision questions. You are introduced with a list of terms of the lecture. Use the following references for further learning.